Are you excited to get into the Word? Amen. So I won't drag it out anymore as they're handing out these. We are also going to leave these cards on the table outside, in between the two exit doors there. So if you want to take more with you, you can do that. This morning I'm having my daughter Jasmine come not only as a treat and a blessing for my wife, but I believe with all of my heart that God has put a word on her heart for this church. And I remember the first day that my dad asked me to preach, and I was scared out of my mind. And now I'm sure people wish I would stop being scared. I would continue to do that. But so I'm excited to be able to present one of the most amazing miracles in my life and in our life. My wife and I. Always a comedy act around here. To my wife and I. God has blessed us with this beautiful young woman. She was a little girl, and she would sing in the hospital after the surgery. She had this little radio with a microphone, and she would sing along with Gary Oliver, and she would mimic T.D. Jakes on there and said, "I came to jerk the covers. I came to un." And there she was. I unveiled the facts. She was all preaching to the nurses. And so I believe that that day was a reflection. God spoke to us when we were fearful that she was going to pass away. And Benny Hinn prayed and prophesied over her that she was going to be a threat to the terror of her day, more than the terror of her day would be a threat to her. And so this morning, I'm excited and I'm proud and I'm honored to turn this over to my daughter. So would you stand and welcome my daughter this morning? She comes to preach, Jasmine Chavez.
Applause. Woo! Amen. It's good to see everybody today. Some new faces, I was going to say old faces, but I didn't want to be mean. Can you turn it down a tad bit? Woo. All right. Amen. So the title of my message today is called Consumed. All right, so if you want to turn your Bibles to Hebrews 12, 25 through 27. Say amen when you're there. I'm going to pray. Father God, I thank you. I thank you for who you are in our lives, Father God, in my life, and I thank you for the opportunity to speak to your people today, Father God. I pray they wouldn't be my words that come out of my mouth, but your words, for you know what they need to hear today, not me. I pray that whatever comes out of my mouth just speaks into their lives, that they would be able to be consumed by you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hebrews 12:25 says, "So don't turn a deaf ear to these gracious words. If those who ignored earthly warnings didn't get away with it, what will happen to us if we turn our backs on heavenly warnings? His voice that shook the earth to its foundations, this time, he's told us this quite plainly, he'll also rock the heavens. One last shaking from top to bottom, stem to stern. The phrase one last shaking means a thorough house cleaning, getting rid of all of the historical and religious junk so that the unshakable essentials stand clear and uncluttered. 28, 29. Do you see what we've got? An unshakable kingdom. And do you see how thankful we must be? Not only thankful, but brimming with worship. Deeply reverent before God, for God is an indifferent bystander. He's actively cleaning house, torching all that needs to burn, and he won't quit until it is all cleansed. God himself is fire." So I was reading this, and I actually was listening to a sermon in the car, so I kind of got to give credit to Matt Poole, because he was what sparked this this idea. And I was thinking, you know, growing up in church, I've always heard the saying, I'm on fire for God, or I want to be on fire for God. And I just got used to saying it. Yeah, I want to be on fire for God. I can't wait to be on fire for God. You know, like, I want to burn for you, God. But I never really understood what it meant. Because you see, if God is an all-consuming fire and we are actively seeking him, wouldn't we be totally consumed? Wouldn't we be so on fire for God that we would be able to be sold out? People would notice. But do people notice that you're on fire for God? Do people even know that you're a Christian? So I was thinking about that. I'm like, okay, fire. Okay, so what is fire? Because I'm like, I need to understand. God is a consuming fire. What is fire? You know, I know fire burns and it's a flame. You can light a candle. I know that kind of fire. But if God is fire, so I researched fire. The definition of fire is the phenomenon of combustion manifested in light, in flame, and in heat. And I was like, that's pretty cool. You know, light, flame, heat. And I was just like, three things. And I was like, wow, okay, God is fire, made of light, flame, and heat. And God, there's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And I was like, whoa, that is so awesome. You know, this is how I read things. I would text my dad. I'm like, oh my gosh, Dad, this is what I found. So I was like, wow, that's awesome, because, you know, the light is obviously Jesus. Talks about in John 8:12. Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness, because you will have the light that leads to life. And the flame, everybody knows, is usually the Holy Spirit, because that is what we can see when we come to service and the Spirit is moving. That's what we feel. But none of that would be there without heat, which is God. And so I was like, wow, this is amazing. I was like, okay, fire, fire. And here I go looking into all these. And then it was just, it more dawned on me because of all the fires that were going down in Yarnell. And I was like, man, this is like devastating. You know, fire is just one of the most devastating things. Like floods, I mean, are devastating as well. But fire, once you burn something, you can never get it back. That's it. Unless you try to put the ashes together and mold it into whatever it used to be, it's never going to be the same. And I was like, wow, fire. But this is what got me here. So there's light, flame, and heat that makes fire. But there's three things that are needed to make fire, if that makes sense. There's heat, which is God. There's fuel, which is Jesus, and there's oxygen, which is the Holy Spirit. And I was like, wow, God, you really think of things, don't you? I was like, this is awesome. Like, when you take the time to actually think of what the Bible just says, oh, yeah, God's a consuming fire. That's nice. You know, that's good. Consuming fire is good. And we think of it to it. It's figuratively speaking, you know, the Bible has a lot of metaphors and awesome. God's a consuming fire. But when you're saying that you want to be on fire for God, that is what it is. The light, the flame, the heat, that is fire. You have to have God. You have to have the Holy Spirit. You have to have Jesus to be completely on fire for God. So I was thinking about this, and I was like, yeah, that's nice, God. You know, you're cool. Like, you think of all these amazing things, and you show us this, and it's like a revelation. I said, but wouldn't fire burn out? Doesn't it burn out? And it was just like, you know, if it's an all-consuming fire, it doesn't burn out. So you've heard the saying in church, oh, I'm burnt out, Pastor. I can't do this anymore, Pastor. You know, I can't volunteer in the nursery anymore, because at home I'm going through this and I'm going through that, and I'm just burnt out, Pastor. I'm sorry, I can't help. I can't volunteer. I'm going through this, I'm going through that, and I'm burnt out. And I'm gonna be honest with you, I have said that many times, you know. Growing up, I've been singing up here since I was 10. And I went through, and I'll give a little testimony, I went through time of bitterness and ugly stuff. You know, growing up in the ministry, you see a lot. And living, being a pastor's kid, you just see that much more. And I was very, very angry, like Shane said. I was very angry and very bitter because I would see these people come to the church, and I did it with my grandpa when he's the pastor, and now my dad was the pastor. And they come and they, my dad, my mom would pour out so much on them. They would pour out so much on them. And where were they when they said that they had their back, you know? And it took time. It took years for me to learn forgiveness. And that was a tough one. Forgiveness is a tough one, I'll tell you that. But it took years for me to realize that they don't do it. They don't do it for the man. They don't do it for man. They do it for God. And when you're doing something for God, he's a consuming fire. And that fire shouldn't burn out if you're consumed. And so I would be up here singing, and I would be like, yeah, I'm tired of singing. I don't want to be up here anymore. When do I get a break? Everybody else gets a break, and I never get a break. And it wasn't even until a few years ago that I realized, why do I need a break from, do I need a break from God? Because this is my ministry. This is where God has placed me. This is the gift he has given me, and I need a break from it? I'm burnt out, really? And it just hit me. And so this sermon, like, I'm just telling you, it got me first. So I was like, ouch, God, ouch. And you know, it's a struggle because life happens, you know? So if we want to be on fire for God, and God's a consuming fire, and we want to stay on fire for God, how many know that I love firemen. Firemen are awesome. They save so many people. But if you want to be on fire for God and you want to be burning, then how many know firemen aren't your friend? You do not want them to put your fire out. So God revealed to me that a lot of the times that's what happens. What happens is, let me explain something to you about fire, okay? So when a few years ago there was a big fire going on, I think it was in Prescott. I think it was in Prescott, actually. I don't remember. But there was a fire going on that it just got way, way out of proportion. And the fire marshal, when it happened, he was like, I told you guys we should have made fire lines. And what fire lines are is what they do is they take out all the fuel. And if you look at it from above, it looks like a big checkerboard. Because that way, if something catches on fire in one section, it won't get carried over to the next one and continue to burn. They cut the fuel out. And how many know that fuel is needed for fire, like I said? So I was like, okay, God. Fuel's needed for fire. There's fire breaks, fire lines. Awesome. Sorry, this is just how I think. Me and God talk, this is how we talk. And I was like, okay. And he was like, that's what happens with people's walks with me. He says what they do is they create fire lines or fire breaks in their life. That way they give this section of their life to God, and this section is burning, but this section over here, they don't want God to have that. So what happens is when a storm comes or anything like that, the fire gets put out immediately because it's a small section. So how many know that's not a consuming fire? So we can also make those fire lines. I definitely made those fire lines in my life with the bitterness and the unforgiveness and everything in my life. I'm like, okay, God, this you can have, this you can't have, this relationship you can have, this you can't have. And so this section's on fire, this section's on fire. But God, I want to be on fire for you. In Deuteronomy 4:23-24, it says, be careful not to forget the covenant of the Lord your God that he made with you. Do not make for yourselves an idol in the form of anything the Lord your God has forbidden. For the Lord your God is a consuming fire, a jealous God. How many know that when stuff like that comes in our lives, the firemen come in our lives, the fire breaks in our lives come in, those become an idol. Because it's because of that that God can't consume you. You're cutting off, saying, God, this is where I'm at. Come set me on fire, but wait, not this side. I don't want to give up my relationship. I don't want to give up this friendship. I don't want to give up sexual immorality. I don't want to give up drugs. I don't want to give up partying and drinking. But God set me on fire. And we wonder why. Oh, I'm so depressed. Oh, I have such anxiety. Why can't I overcome this? Why can I not forgive my brother? Why do I carry all of this on me? Why do I feel so sad, God? Because we're not consumed. We're not consumed with the all-consuming fire. He's given us a taste, but he won't force himself on you unless you ask him to come into your life. And he's not going to push his fire on you if you're not ready for it. So fire lines, firemen. I've had so many, many, many of those things in my life. Yes, I'm a pastor's kid. Yes, I went through a rough time. I didn't go partying. I didn't go drinking. None of that. I never really had the desire for that. But I let just little things here and there cause my life to be broken up in sections. And I was like, God, why do I feel so alone? You know, my parents are here. I have the church. I know you're here. But God, I feel so alone. I feel like everybody says, you have such a calling on your life. You have such a calling on your life. You're going to do great things. And I'm standing here like, really? Me? Do you know what I've done? Do you know what I've thought? Do you know what I've said? And a lot of the times that is also what holds us back. That becomes another fire line. God can't use me. I did this and I did that. I said this. I had a baby before I got married. God can't use me. How can you use that? And we begin to section off, and then we allow the firemen in life to come and put us out. They're the people that come into your life and they're like, oh, you're serving God? You're not cool anymore. How come you don't like to do what we used to do? You've changed. How many have heard that one? You're not like you used to be. You think you're better than me now? Come on, I've heard that one. Oh, you're a pastor's kid. And I get that look. Oh. I keep it real too. So I was just going through this and I was like, man, I'm a metaphor analogy person. I love when I can connect things to like real life things because it makes more sense instead of just God's a consuming fire. Amen. You know, I like to piece things together and I was just like, wow, God. How many of us are in that situation right now? I mean, I'll be honest, it's a struggle. It's a struggle to be able to say, God, here's my life. Burn this fuel right here, God, so it burns for you. It's a struggle daily because I work, I have a job, I have a 4-year-old. I live at home with my parents. It's a struggle. It's a constant battle. So I was thinking of this and I was like, okay, so firemen put out fires. Fire lines stop the fire from spreading. What else can put out the fire? And it was storms. Storms can put out a fire. Anyone trying to stop a fire loves when a storm comes. Why? Because the clouds come and they cover the heat, which is the source, the sun. So the clouds come and they cover the sun, which the heat source is needed to build the fire, to spread the fire. And also because of the rain. The rain saturates all the fuel. That way nothing can catch on fire if it's wet. So I was like, wow, okay. Everybody say, I'm going through a storm, you know. I'm going through this. I'm going through that. I'm just going through all these struggles. And it's just storm after storm after storm. And I just can't seem to catch a break. And I've been through there too. Many times. It's just like one thing after another, one thing after another. And you're trying to stay on fire for God, but these storms keep coming. And they keep putting you out. Why? Because you've created fire lines and your fire is small. if it's a consuming fire, fire, water can't put out that fire. So I'm there thinking like, man, that's what I've gone through my whole life. That's it. I'm like, I've been like, God, I want to be on fire for you. And yeah, pieces of me are on fire for God. We're on fire for God, but not all of me. I didn't want to give up a relationship. I didn't want to give up my bitterness. I didn't want to give up my forgiveness for God to consume me fully. And then I wonder why when the storms come and the trials come, I'm like, I'm burnt out, God. I don't have anything left for you, God. I'm tired. I'm worn out. I'm depressed. God, what is this? And that's when he says, it's because you've blocked yourself off. You haven't given this side of you to me. You haven't given that to me. You haven't given this to me. So how can I consume your life with fire when you've created these barriers that stop it? I was like, man, that's awesome. I was like, wow. And how many of us here today are, you've seen the people come. Their church is filled. They're on fire for God. They're up here at the front praising God. Yes, God, fill me up, God. And then a couple Sundays go by, and where are they? You look at their Facebook status, partying at the club. Yeah. And it's just like, whoa, weren't they just on fire for God? No, they were not. Because if they were on fire for God, all of that would be burning. It wouldn't be put out by a little storm. Oh, my boyfriend broke up with me. I'm not on fire for God anymore. Oh, I lost my job. I'm not on fire for God anymore. No, no. In the midst of those storms, in the midst of the storms, that consuming fire would be burning. It would still be burning because... why? Because our source is God. No matter what the clouds cover, we know that the source is still there. Even though you cannot see God, even though you may be able to feel the heat when it's stormy outside like today, God is there and he is in your midst. You just gotta listen and recognize that. You are the one that has to make your life available to God. You are the fuel. If you don't give God fuel to burn, what is there to burn? There's nothing. And I was like, man, this is awesome. So I was like, okay, storms put out fire because they block the sun. The rain comes. So, okay, God, when the storms come, you're blocked and people feel alone. The rain comes. I said, but what happens after that? I'm like, the storm comes and it puts out our fire. Like, how are we going to be on fire for you if you're going to be put out? There was a fire, I think it was Yellowstone National Park, that was started by lightning. So when the storms come, what comes with storms? Lightning. So what happens is, when you're in life and the storms come and the rain has drenched everything you had, and you can't see the sun, and you can't feel God in the situation, and you feel lost, and you feel alone, lightning comes. And the biggest fire known was caused by one touch of lightning. Why? How? It's more of a question, because if it can find any little piece of fuel left, it strikes. And the fire is bigger and better and stronger and more uncontrollable than before. So I'm here to tell you today that if you're in the middle of a storm and you can't see God and it just keeps storm and storm and you feel like there's nothing left of you, nothing, no fire left, one touch of God to come down into your life to find that fuel, and the fire begins to spread. And I've been there. I have been there when I'm like, God, there's no hope left. Here I am. I'm coming to church every day. And that's all I have left. But, God, there's just storm after storm. I just don't see how I can come out of this, God. I don't see where you are in this. And I was reading in Job yesterday, and it was kind of funny because Job was like complaining, and God, why me, blah, blah, blah. And he's going off because, you know, the story of Job, all this bad stuff happened to him. And then I was laughing because I'm a very sarcastic person. And God answers him just like, Job, like, you're gonna listen and you're gonna answer to me. And he starts telling him, who was there when the earth was created? Who was there who said where the oceans would start? Who said when they would stop? And pretty much just telling Job, like, Job, why are you concerned when I am your maker? I am your creator. I'm the one that knows what is going to be before you. Why won't you just trust in me? And that's the same thing in the storm. You just got to know. It has to stay in your mind that God is there, even though you may not see him, even though you may not feel the heat, he's there. And a storm is crashing and the winds are blowing and the rain is putting out all of your fire and it's saturating all the fuel. Lightning comes and it strikes down and starts to burn the fire even bigger than before. And what happens is, because there's still, you know, you still have the fire lines in your life. The lightning comes and it strikes one, and it becomes bigger and bigger. It starts the fire again, but wind begins to carry the embers. And it doesn't matter where the fire lines are. It doesn't matter what you have in your life. When the Holy Spirit comes and he blows in your life, it's going to surpass those fire lines. It's going to surpass the firemen and blow until everything becomes consumed with God's fire. So in Acts 2, it says, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from the heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be the tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Blowing of a violent wind. We've been speaking on the Holy Spirit. And I didn't really want to get off the topic of that. So this kind of brings it back into the Holy Spirit. When God sends his lightning down, it doesn't matter what you've been through. It doesn't matter what barriers you've put up. It doesn't matter who has come into your life to try to put your fire out. When the Holy Spirit moves in your life and blows, it blows the embers and catches everything on fire. The fire doesn't care what's there. It doesn't care what the fuel is. It begins to light everything on fire and become consumed. So here's what got me. So I'm like, wow, that's awesome. Fire. Fire's awesome. God's consuming. And sorry, I'm losing my voice already. But after a fire's been burning for so long and it can't be put out or controlled, what happens is it begins to change the atmosphere and the weather begins to change. It's a natural thing made by God that it begins to change the atmosphere. That way the storms can roll in and cover the sun and be able to pour rain and put the fire out. And I know I'm probably sounding like I'm contradicting myself because that's what I told God. I was like, okay, well, how come we're supposed to be on fire for you? Then the storm isn't a good thing. You just said. But what he pointed out was when that rain comes, when everything has been consumed and it's been burning and burning and burning, the rain begins to bring refreshing, renewal, and regrowth. So when you're burning on fire, I'm on fire for you, God, and everything is going great, and everything is going great, and you just begin to feel God's presence pour out on you, that storm, that's not really a storm. It changed the atmosphere of the weather pattern. It changed the whole weather. Imagine that. A fire that burns so much that it changes the weather pattern. So once it brings regrowth, what happens when that happens? It provides more fuel to burn again. So it's going to be a constant battle. And like the one thing I like to use is the fire when it's going burning up like a hill or a mountain, and it burns faster because everybody knows heat rises. So it's going up and it's burning and it's burning. You're going up this mountain. You're going good at your job. You're getting extra money. Like your relationship is going good. You're getting blessed. God is in your midst. And you get to the top of the mountain. You're like, yeah, I made it to the top of the mountain. I'm on fire for you, God. But what happens? You can't stay on top of that mountain forever. You're going to have to come down. And when you come down, it's going to feel like your fire is being put out because it's harder to go back down. The fire is harder when you're going down, but you're going to have to go up the hill, burn on fire for God. And you're the one that's going to have to make the fuel available to God to burn when you're coming down that hill. So when everything is not going good for you, when nothing is going good at your job, when nothing is going good for you with your family and you're coming down the hill, God, why is this happening? God, why am I going through this? You create the fuel for God to burn, so that way you can continue your fuel going, so that way you can go up the next mountain and back down, because that's why the Bible talks about going from glory to glory, because it's not going to be, you can't stay at the top of the mountain. We live in a fallen world. Nothing is going to be perfect. You're going to have trials. You're going to have storms. You're going to go through things, but it's when you say, God, I'm available to you. Father, I pray that you burn in me, Father God, anything that is not of you. That's, you want to know how you're on fire for God? When you give everything to God and you say, burn, burn in me, God, anything that is not of you, so that I can be full of only you. That's how you know you're on fire for God. That's how you know. When you're able to say, God, today I am not in a good mood. I woke up on the wrong side of the bed today. But how many know that being mean and being snappy and crabby is not of God? So when times like that come, or you're at work and somebody is irritating the crap out of you. Sorry, I think I said crap. Oh. And you just want to wring their neck because they're not working and you're working, and then you get in trouble for nothing. Not that I've gone through that or anything. When stuff like that comes and you're able to just say, God, this is not of you. This is me. This is my flesh. This is the fuel. Please set this fuel on fire. That way when stuff like that comes and your family members come at you and all this stuff comes and you feel like, okay, I'm not on fire for you, God, right now. I can't do this on my own. God, use this fuel, God, and burn, Father. Whatever it is that is not of you, burn it away, Father God. Let me be consumed by your fire, God. Let me be consumed by you, that nothing else in my life is you. Nothing else in my life is nothing but you, God. Nothing but you, God. And I pray today, Father God, that you would just consume my life with you. And it's a daily thing. You don't think that our family goes through trials? You don't think that we go through storms? We're human. We go through stuff all the time. It doesn't get easy when you become a Christian. I'm sure everybody's heard that. It's not easy. It's not going to be like, I'm a Christian now. I'm going to be skipping along and happy all the time. No. If anything, it gets harder because the devil is mad that he does not have you all up in the club. He doesn't have you drinking. He doesn't have you addicted to drugs. He's going to be like, man, I lost one. And he's going to be coming at you with all these storms trying to put the fire out. But you know what? Our God is a consuming fire. And it doesn't matter what comes. God, Holy Spirit will blow and the Holy Spirit will come and overtake your life. And it doesn't matter what the devil tries to bring at you. It doesn't matter what the storm comes, because God can consume all that too. The story of Elijah one of the stories, he had them bring like he made like an altar. I'm not good at explaining stories. And he had them go and lay down their idols or whatever, and then he had them go and get water and pour it on there, and then he made them build like a trench around it. So they were when they had to go get water, and they poured it all on top, and it was surrounded by water. And he prayed, and what happened? God's fire came down, and it consumed all of that and the water. So when the storm comes, and you feel like, man, I don't have any fuel left. Man, I can't burn on fire for you, God, because I just feel so soaked in all this sadness. I feel soaked in depression. I feel soaked in all of this. God can consume all that. Because a consuming fire, it doesn't matter what it is. It'll consume all of that. So 4D, you can come out and start setting up. It's a constant battle. That's why it says pick up your cross daily. Daily. Not monthly, not weekly.
You can take it. Watch out my water though.
Not monthly. They're setting up for a human video because everybody knows I love human videos. They just get the point across even better. I just came to realize through this whole thing that this is the reason our church isn't growing. Not because we're not trying, not because we're not doing outreach, not because we're not doing anything, but because each of us individually are not completely on fire for God. Because if we were, and people came in here, and the Holy Spirit moved, this whole place would be consumed. And people would be coming, running to this place, saying, I want to be on fire too. I want to know what it is that's so different about you at work. I want to know what it is that, why you're so happy all the time. I want to know. Take me to where you go. But we're not. And I'm guilty of that too. God wants you to know that it doesn't matter what you have in your life. Because once you come here, and once we're all together, and the Holy Spirit just moves in our midst, we become a consuming fire. And you know what? I believe that God is going to consume us all, and that we begin to burn, and we become a consuming church, consuming fire church, that not only do we begin to change the atmosphere here in our church, but we begin to change the atmosphere in the city, that we begin to change the atmosphere in the country, that we begin to change the atmosphere in the world. We are Phoenix World Outreach. We're not Phoenix Outreach. We're not Phoenix just inner city outreach. We are Phoenix World Outreach. So begin to let God consume you. Say, God, set a fire in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control, God. God, I want more of you, less of me, and more of you, God. God, set a fire in my soul. Set a fire deep in me that surpasses any barrier, that surpasses anybody trying to put it out, God. Surpasses every storm. Set a consuming fire in me that when you rain down and you bring refreshing, that I would continue to grow and be more, build more fuel and be more able for you, God. This is just something that we need to get in our spirit, each and every one of us, because it's tiring. It's tiring. We live in a fallen world. We're human. But we need to rely on God and the Holy Spirit and give him the fuel needed to burn in our lives. Watch this video. Amen. I hope this ministered to somebody today. So, if you're feeling just so lost and alone, and you want to be on fire for God, or you were on fire for God and now you're just burnt out, I want you to come today. Let us pray over you. That way, when we're all in one accord and the Holy Spirit begins to move, we can all just be consumed by God's fire. So if you bow your heads and pray. Father God, I thank you for the opportunity be able to be a vessel that you would speak through me today. I pray, Father God, that you would just speak to their hearts. No matter what the situation, no matter how old they are. If they're going through something, if they're in the middle of the storm, just remind them that you're there in their midst. That if you just, that they would just give you just a little fuel, you'll send your lightning down and set them ablaze. So one, on the count of three, if this explains you, if it explains your life, on the count of three, I just want you to just run to the altar. Cry out to God and say, consume me, God. Two, say, God, set a fire in my soul that I can't contain. No matter what I do, no matter what I put in my life, no matter what barriers I put or who I allow in my life, I pray that you would just consume me, God. Send down your lightning. Set me on fire for you, God. Three, come and let God consume you with his fire. Let him burn away all that isn't of him, because that is when you can be at peace. If you've just been coming to church, that's not going to get you into heaven. One thing I realize is we can either burn now for God, or we can burn in hell for eternity.